Hello, everyone, and thank you for being here. To talk completely about the life of Eddie Rickenbacker would take much longer than the time we have here. So what I'm going to do tonight is talk a little bit about early experiences in his life, which were so key to forging his career as a fighter pilot, and then cover two of the most important incidents of his life after World War I that really sort of fixed his course and his place in American history. So Edward Vernon Rickenbacker was born October 8, 1890 in Columbus, Ohio. His parents, William and Lisa Rickenbacker, were both immigrated from Switzerland. William worked as a laborer doing various construction jobs, road paving, things like that. Lisa was a housekeeper and did laundry. They built, William built a family home for them in the early 1900s, and they lived in a fairly well-to-do Swiss neighborhood in Columbus. Rickenbacker, as a child, was, by all accounts, a fairly decent student, but was somewhat rambunctious, like to prank the neighborhood, engage in minor vandalism, and many of the people in the community thought that this would have roused the temper of his father, for if there was one thing that everyone knew, William Rickenbacker had a temper, and one day it would cause a problem. That day came in 1904. William Rickenbacker was out with leading a street paving crew fixing one of the streets. They took a break for lunch, and an African-American laborer named William Gaines approached them. Gaines asked to borrow some food, and whatever he did incensed William Rickenbacker. A fight broke out. Gaines picked up a paving level, which is a large straight piece of metal, and smashed in William Rickenbacker's head. He ran off and was arrested by the police, and William Rickenbacker lapsed into a coma and 5 weeks later died. Mr. Gaines was found guilty and sentenced to 10 years in prison for manslaughter. Because of this, Ed Rickenbacker knew that he would have to step up, so he dropped out of school and started doing a number of jobs. He couldn't really settle on something he liked, but he finally found something that interested him when he was walking through the streets of downtown Columbus one day, and he found a crowd gathered around a machine, and the person standing by it was a representative of Ford Motor Company who was touring the country selling the two-seater Roadster. Ed convinced the gentleman to give him a ride, and he fell in love with the sensation of speed. Cars were to go on to be an important part of his life. In this slide, you can see this. I apologize, it's got out of order somehow. Went too far. Ed went to work at the Columbus, Ohio Railway Company, where he learned to operate machines and lathes. But he loved the mechanical work and working with all the designs and everything, but he wasn't entirely satisfied with the job. While he was working at that job, he suffered an industrial accident. A wheel fell off a wagon that was carrying some of the metal they were working with and crushed his leg. While recovering, he had time to reflect on where he was and decided that he really loved cars and he wanted to get into that industry. So he quit his job at the Columbus Works and went to work for a man named Lee Freyer, who was with the Columbus Buggy Company. The Columbus Buggy Company was designing a car called first Ed did some studying, and he went to he took a correspondence school course that taught him engineering, and he used that to parlay into working for Lee Freyer, which is this gentleman here, at the Columbus Buggy Company. Auto racing had become a big thing in the time, and one of the premier races at that point was the Long Island Vanderbilt Cup, held by the Vanderbilt family. Freyer and Rickenbacker went there. Rickenbacker went as Freyer's crew chief, and they raced, and they did okay, but Rick found out that he really enjoyed automobile racing. As a result of that, Freyer was hired by the Firestone Columbus Company to manufacture and design their Firestone Columbus automobile, which you can see here. And he took Rick along as his chief tester and engineer. So Rick got a chance to do what he loved, driving fast cars and everything else. He also became, from there, he got a job as a demonstrator selling the cars. He went to Texas and sold the Firestone Columbus. And then he was stationed in Ohio doing sales. And he had an accident that would actually affect his life in the way this seemed to have happened several times, that one day while looking out his office, an ember from a passing locomotive got in his eye, and he lost 30% of his peripheral vision in his right eye, which is an incredible handicap for both a race driver and a pilot. Well, about that time, it was 1911, and the city of Indianapolis was looking for a way to publicize itself as a tourist destination. So they decided they would create a race, a 500-mile endurance race that would test the greatest drivers in the United States. Lee Freire wanted to enter this, and he knew there was only one man he wanted as a co-driver, and that was Rickenbacker. So he called him and asked him to come out in Indianapolis. 80,000 people showed up to watch the first race, and 40 drivers completed for $27,550 in prize money. Ed drove 400 miles of the race, and Freire finished the last 100, and the team finished in 11th place. This solidified for Ed that he wanted to be a race car driver, but unfortunately he didn't have the money to get into it to buy his own car or purchase his own team. So he had to sign on with a traveling group that traveled around the country performing driving exhibitions and racing in local races. Eventually he was able to parlay that into a driver position with the Duesenberg brothers, who would build the famous Duesenberg car. They had come over from Europe and were doing race car drivers. And his success in winning there led to him being promoted to his own racing team by the Prestolite Battery Company. When Rickenbacker was given his own team, he was one of the first people to introduce time and motion studies and the new management sciences into how his pit crew functioned. So the people that crewed and serviced his cars, he actually drilled them in how to change the tire, how to change the oil, what to do, and made them practice the moves over and over. And they were actually able to cut much time off their pit stops, and that gave him an edge in racing. While he was traveling around the country as a racer, he had the two encounters that would ensure his interest in aviation. The first occurred in California, where he saw a gentleman standing by an airplane on a runway and went out to talk to him. That man turned out to be Glenn L. Martin, a pioneer aviator and the founder of Martin Aviation. Martin took Ed up for his first flight, and Ed thought that what he was doing was almost as fun as racing. Ed also had to be convinced, because he was slightly afraid of heights, and he and Glenn Martin convinced him that being in a plane was much different than being in a building, and Ed found out that was true. Later during that same race season, he was traveling along when he saw a biplane landed in a field with a gentleman. That man was Major Townsend F. Dodd, who was a pilot in the United States Army Signal Corps. At that time, military aviation was in the United States, at least, was under the United States Army, and it was part of the Signal Corps, because the initial uses for aircraft had been as observation and scout craft, and that was considered part of the signals job. Rickenbacker went over, and without having ever worked on a plane before, was immediately able to diagnose the problem with the engine, fix it, and get Major Townsend on his way. And this was a trait that Rickenbacker often showed, the natural intelligence of understanding machines. So Rickenbacker was a fairly successful racer, but in 1916, one of his sponsors asked him to travel to Europe so he could go around and get various designs and engineering schematics, tour the factories, and see if there was any surplus racing machines that weren't being used for the war effort. So Rickenbacker traveled to England, and it was his first time ever being out of the country, and it was the first time that he became aware of class divisions and seeing how stratified British society was at the time. He never really knew that, and that would affect his attitude later in World War I. The other big issue with his European trip was when he landed in England, he was immediately confronted by British intelligence, and they drug him into an office, searched through all his baggage, and said, "We think you're a German spy." Their evidence that consisted of being a German spy was the fact that in the 1914 race season, an overeager PR officer had referred to him as the boy racer Baron von Rickenbacker, and the Germans were absolutely convinced that he was a German spy. While over in England, Ed found out about the pilots, and he, listening to the stories and accounts of the World War I aviators, the British and the French, who were already over fighting the war, he realized that there were a group of people in America that perfectly suited for this job that required daring, mechanical know-how, and speed. So when he came back to America, he set out to recruit an all-racing volunteer aviation squadron. He traveled across the country and got many of his racing colleagues to sign on, and then he approached the Signal Corps, and he ran into Brigadier General George E. Squire, who promptly told him that the U.S. Army Signal Corps was no place for people who were not officers, who were not educated, who were too old. Rickenbacker was 27, the minimum age was 25, and that they were actually distrustful of engineers flying aircraft because engineers knew so much about the machines, they might be afraid to push them to the limit. The U.S. Army Signal Corps at that time had a reputation of being called the Millionaire's Guard because it was primarily made up of West Point grads, people from old money East Coast families. Yale and Harvard both produced aviation units solely composed of Yale and Harvard pilots. So Rickenbacker would need another way if he wanted to get into World War I. So he came back to America and prepared to start racing in the 1917 season. Well, about that time, America finally declared war, and the man selected to lead the American war effort was General John J. Pershing. Pershing was going to take a small headquarters staff over to France to scout out the battlefields ahead of the arrival of the main American forces. And someone in the government thought that since he would need to be driven around this active war zone, they would need somebody who was skilled at driving fast, driving in rough conditions, with good reflexes and mechanical skills. So they decided to pick a race car driver to serve as General John J. Pershing's personal driver. Well, the man they picked, who was the head of the American Racing Association, said the only man for the job is Eddie Rickenbacker. So they offered it to Rickenbacker, and Rickenbacker found himself aboard the SS Baltic on his way to Europe. Once he got aboard the SS Baltic, he found out that being a private in the army was kind of terrible. He was stuck below deck, so one day he went out and he found Major Townsend Dodge was on the ship with him, and he remembered him as the inventive young man who had fixed his plane, and so Rick asked him to promote him, so he got a promotion and became a sergeant and was better able to enjoy the trip. When they arrived in France, Rickenbacker had some fame because there were some French racers that traveled to America and knew him, and he spent most of his time driving Brigadier General, or General Pershing, and later he drove Major Townsend, and he also drove Billy Mitchell, who was the second in command of the U.S. Army Air Service at that time and would eventually go on to become a general. Rick really wanted to fly, though, and driving around generals, while good for his career and a positive thing, wasn't getting there. So one day in France, he happened to bump into a gentleman of his acquaintance named James E. Miller. He was a New York banker who had been appointed in charge of the American training effort in World War I. The Americans had been given a base called Isodune, which was a French training facility that had been turned over to them, and he needed someone who could get the base up and running because they were having trouble with supplies and the American military system wasn't meshing well with the French attitude and the way they did things. So Rickenbacker said he would take over as head of this facility if they would send him to aviation flight school. So he approached General Mitchell and made the deal. He had to lie about his age. He told them he was 25 when he was really 27. And he was shipped off to the 2nd Aviation Instruction Center at Tours, France. Until Isodune was up and running, all the American troops would be trained under French fighters and French pilots. And the French had a specific training program that they used. The cadets first learned to do these Morien Saliner monoplanes, which we'll call penguins, because if you see these short wings, they actually had the wings cut off, so they weren't able to achieve any flight. They were just able to be driven around the ground. But it taught the pilots how to handle their aircraft and everything. And then later, when they went to flight training, they advanced to the Calderon biplane. And if you'll notice the wing structure on here, instead of using flaps and rudders, the Calderon biplane used what they call wing warping, like the Wright Flyer, where the wing actually bends to control the aircraft. Rickenbacker passed his flight training. He had some issues due to the damage in his eye. Landing was, as he said himself, difficult. He generally sort of had to throw his aircraft at the ground. So he practiced until by rote he sort of knew how to gauge where he was and then made landings that were passable. And so he passed his flight training in 17 days and was commissioned a first lieutenant in the U.S. Army Signal Corps. So fulfilling his obligation, he traveled to Issoudun, France. While there, he was able to use the same sort of know-how he used in leading his pit crew to gin up the American efforts. He helped dredge latrines, laid walkways, fixed supply problems, cut out some overages, dodged the British, who were still following him around, thinking he was still going to sabotage the American war effort because they still thought he was a German spy. And he also, maybe on purpose, maybe just because it was, kind of took it out on some of these millionaire brigade candidates who came through, these East Coast scions who he had dig ditches, fill the latrines, do all the regular army things they weren't quite used to, which here alienated from the men, and later when he got to squadrons where he had to serve with these people, he already started a thing down. But he did manage to make one friend. He met another pilot named Reed Chambers, who became his best friend. Eventually, though, Ed really wanted to get into combat training, or combat flying, and he couldn't be a combat pilot until he passed gunnery school. But the commanders of Issoudun were afraid to let him go because they thought the base would fall apart. So Ed, who cut corners every now and again, put himself on sick leave for 2 weeks and proved that basically the base would still continue to function without him. So at that point, they were forced to grant him his rear, and he was sent to gunnery training at Carzo, France. Now, the gunnery training started with learning to fire a shotgun. Ed had apparently only shot a gun once in his life before he arrived in World War I. Once you proved you could hit a stationary target on land, they transferred you to a speedboat with your shotgun, and you stood in the back of a speedboat. Another speedboat pulled the target around on the lake, and you tried to shoot the target. When you could do that, they put you up in a Newport 19, and you shot a banner that was hanging from another plane that would pull it, and you tried to shoot it. Well, apparently on Rick's first time up in the training plane, he got a little close to the tail, and the French pilots made an emergency dive for the ground and landed, and there was much consternation. But after firing hundreds of rounds and compensating for his right eye, which still he sort of never really told anyone that he had, because it probably would have meant the end of his flying career, he managed to get certified and was assigned to a combat squadron. The combat squadron he was sent to was the 94th Aero Squadron. It was part of the 1st Pursuit Group along with its sister unit, the 95th, and they were stationed at Villeneuve Les Vertus. When the Americans first arrived in France, there was some debate. Marshal Foch, who was the commander of the French forces, wanted the American divisions immediately plugged into the French lines under French commanders fighting with the French units. Pershing really wanted the American forces to train and be applied as a unit, one, because he felt they would work better, and two, it would give the American army experience in acting as a unified army instead of having to deal with French commands. So when Ed got there, the only problem was the 94th Aero Squadron didn't have any planes. The 95th Squadron had planes, and they lorded it over the 94th Squadron about how they were going to be the first in to fight and win all the honors. And the 94th and 95th were both made up of pilots that Rick had been particularly hard on during their training, and he found himself ostracized. But fortunately for him, Reed Chambers showed up, and they got into the 94th. And this is the main 94th squadron here. Rickenbacker's right here. The 94th was called the Hat in a Ring Gang. Most squadrons had to pick a name and a symbol. The legend goes that the 94th was debating what they would use as their symbol. They had seized upon a stovepipe hat made up of the stars and stripes, but they needed something to do it. So the squadron legend goes that one of the men in the squad who was from Texas said that where he came from, when a man wanted to fight, he threw his hat into the ring to show that he was ready. So that was the insignia they wound up with, a hat and a ring, and you'll see it later on Rickenbacker's plane. Another thing that helped Rickenbacker was he received the aid of two mentors who were kind of standouts in World War I air combat. The 94th Aero Squadron was given as Commander Major Gervais Raoul Loufberry. Loufberry was one of the Lafayette Escadrille. These were men that had been fighting in the French Air Force as pilots since 1915, 1916. When Americans entered the war, they struck a deal where they would be given their same ranks they had in the French Army and would get to keep all their victories that they had accrued. Well, the Army Air Service wasn't happy with that, and they actually were stripped of all the victories they earned in the Lafayette Escadrille, and each came in a rank below where they had been. But Loufberry apparently saw something in Rickenbacker that he thought would make him an excellent combat pilot. So he trained the 94th in the Dicta Bullae, which is a series of eight principles of air-to-air combat developed by the German ace Oswald Bullae. Bullae was probably one of Germany's greatest fighter aces. He probably would have had an equivalent career to the Red Baron, but he was killed in a head-on collision with another plane in 1916. But his principles basically form to this day the modern doctrine of air combat, and they deal with principles of being aggressive and mostly focused around the best way to attack an aircraft is to be above and out of the sun and then dive down on the plane so you take advantage of your dive speed. So armed with this training, and they began to assemble the 94th into a fighting squadron. Rickenbacker was actually chosen for the 94th's first patrol. Eventually, they received planes. They received the Newport 28, which you can see here with the hat and the ring insignia. The Newport 28 was a fairly advanced French plane. It was super fast and highly maneuverable, but many of the American pilots didn't like it, and Rickenbacker really didn't like it because to compensate for his eye, he needed a much slower, heavier plane, so he was grateful when they got the Spad 13, which was a more powerful but slower and not as maneuverable plane, but he could compensate for that because the Newport 28 was, if you made the tiniest move, it would make drastic corrections. So Rickenbacker was taken out on a first patrol with Loufberry and another pilot. They didn't encounter any aircraft, but while they were away, two German aircraft strayed over the 94th's home airfield and were shot down. Rickenbacker's combat career continued like that for a while until finally on March, till he finally encountered a Flaws D-3 reconnaissance plane on a solo mission, and he was able to get behind it and bring it down. His partner in that was James Hall, who was flying as his wingman that day. And the victories, there were two different systems of awarding victories for the Allies. The British had a system whereby you could receive a credit for any aircraft that you downed and a partial credit for any aircraft you were involved in shooting down. It also didn't require that you have independent confirmation. A pilot could report on his own kills and they would be accepted. The French system, which the Americans worked under because they were considered as part of the French, it allowed for full credit for everyone who was involved in a plane. So four people shot down a plane, each one of them would get credit for shooting down that plane. It took five victories to make an ace. And so every American was wondering who would be the first person to make it to ace status because all the Americans who were already aces, the Lafayette Escadrille pilots, had lost their victories. The 94th experienced a number of problems. Raoul Lufbery died. He was battling a German aircraft near the airfield, and he got into an inverted maneuver, and he fell out of his plane and hit the ground and died. Additionally, Hall, who was with Rickenbacker on his first victory, was brought down in what they thought was a collision with another German aircraft, but they began to discover that it kept happening to Newport 28s from their squadron, and it turned out there was actually a flaw in the struts that supported the upper wing called wing shedding. If the 28s got into too violent of a maneuver, it would actually shear off the wing. It happened to Rickenbacker, and he was able, through piloting, to crash land his plane. And so that pretty much spelled the end of equipping the Americans with Newport 28s, and they ordered SPOD 13s from the factory. But the Newport 28s still had to be flown until they had the SPODs. So Ed found himself now with one victory in a battle to be the first American ace. And his main competition for it was another 94th Aero Squadron pilot named Douglas Campbell. They pulled pretty even in the fights, downing a number of Albatross D5s, which were a fighter aircraft, and also the Albatross C1, which was another reconnaissance plane. They were actually even in kills on May 27th when they were both sent on a pull. They had tied the record at 4 each, and they were on patrol, and both of them were involved in shooting down a Albatross C1. But unfortunately, the clerk who recorded the credit only reported that Rickenbacker had been involved and didn't report Campbell's kill. So Ed didn't really admit that Campbell had been involved, and Campbell couldn't really complain because he didn't have any proof. So that was sort of maybe not a Rickenbacker did later admit that he should have given credit to Campbell for the kill, but it didn't matter because Campbell got the next kill ahead of him and became the first British ace. The 94th continued intermittent combat patrols, but was called into battle with the rest of the American Army with the outbreak of the Second Battle of the Marne. The Germans attempted to punch through the stalemated lines and drove all the way to the Marne River from July to August 1918. They eventually were stopped at the Marne by French Moroccan divisions, who were thrown into the line, and also by the American Marines making a stand at Belle Isle Wood and slowing down things. As part of this mission, and in support of the combat additions during the Second Battle of the Marne, Rickenbacker and his men were tasked with attacking what the Germans called Draken and the Allies called Sausages, which were observation balloons. Attacking observation balloons was considered one of the most dangerous things you could do because the balloon was stationary, so they could the Germans would position anti-aircraft guns around it that would fire up. They would guard it with troops. And they would even station squadrons that were solely based near the observation balloon and were designed to protect it. The advantage attackers had was that the balloons were full of flammable hydrogen. So if you hit it with any kind of incendiary force, it would explode and destroy the balloon. Rickenbacker proposed a novel solution for attacking the balloon. He recruited 5 men from his squadron, and his plan was that 3 of the men would approach the balloon from the front, and they would begin doing lots of acrobatic maneuvers and flying around to distract the Germans. The other 2 aircraft would climb to well above the observation balloons, cut their engines and drop, and then right before they reached the observation balloons, they would kick their engines to life, fire off a machine gun pass, blow up the balloon, and then pull out, hopefully before hitting the ground or hitting the flaming balloon. When Rickenbacker went to implement this attack, it failed because his guns jammed right before the balloon. It was found there was more success attacking balloons using the method that Frank Luke Jr., who was another aviator in a different squadron, it was kind of a rival to Rickenbacker, and he and his pilot would basically attack the balloon from 2 directions, and they were fairly successful in confusing the German forces. Rick, at the end of the Second Battle of the Marne, Rick had developed terrible ear infections, so he was sent back to the line in Paris, where they drained his eardrums and removed some abscesses, and it forced him to be recuperated there for a week. While he was there, Clinton Roosevelt, who was the son of President Teddy Roosevelt and was also a pilot, was killed in action during the battle. And this caused Rickenbacker to think that maybe he had only been fortunate to be a pilot so far because he had just been lucky. Better pilots than him had died. Extremely unlucky pilots had died before even getting really off the ground. So he decided he needed to stop making mistakes, and he needed to refocus, and he needed to temper some of his aggression and recklessness that he had shown with some more sensible tactics and things. He went back to his unit, but again was unable to participate in combat because he kept having pain in his ear and head due to the atmosphere changes. Eventually it was discovered that he had infected adenoids, so they did surgery on those, and once they did that, his problems cleared up and he was able to fly again. During that time, Pershing was preparing the Americans for their first offensive. The Germans had pushed a salient around the town of St. Mihiel, so there's basically a 27 or so mile bulge of German troops out into the Allied lines. Pershing was going to lead the Americans in attacking this salient, pushing on the edges and collapsing it. The attack was launched, and when the American forces got there, the Germans were already moving backwards because German high command had decided to abandon the salient and retreat back on the line because it was untenable. During this battle, this is where Rickenbacker earned the Congressional Medal of Honor. In his most famous fight, he had been promoted to lead his squadron because the Army staff saw that he was more mature than the other pilots because he was older than most of the other pilots, although they didn't know that. And his whiz with organization and machines made him the ideal candidate to lead the 94th. So Rickenbacker wanted to demonstrate exactly what kind of leader he was, so he took off on a solo patrol to show his unit, this is the new way we're going to be. While on that patrol, he encountered 7 aircraft, 5 Fokker DV-7s, protecting 2 Halberstadt CL-2 reconnaissance planes. The Fokker was probably one of the best planes the Germans had in the war, and the Halberstadts were incredibly dangerous to attack because although they were slow and low-flying reconnaissance planes, they had this mounted machine gun that could swivel 360 degrees and defend it from the back when the optimum attack was to dive on its rear. Seeing this flight of planes, Rickenbacker dove towards the ground, shot down one of the Fokkers and one of the Halberstadts, and scattered the rest of the aircraft, sending them back across the lines. For this feat, he was awarded the Congressional Medal of Honor in 1930. It was converted from a medal that he received for the action at the time, but in 1930 they upgraded it to the Congressional Medal of Honor. Rick continued to do combat patrols, start amassing things. He became the top ace of aces when the top American ace of aces, Putnam, who had 12 kills, or 12 victories, died himself in battle. Rick only led the ace of ace races for a brief time before Frank Luke overtook it. And Frank Luke was on the path to be probably the most effective combat ace, but he made, during one of his final attack, he chose to make a stand when he crashed against a German rifle platoon, and it didn't work out so well for him. Because of that, and collapsing the St. Mihiel salient, the Americans were ready to push their first attack. The other two battles had been sort of in a smaller attack and a thing, but they were part of the massive Meuse-Argonne offensive, which was an Allied push that would attempt to break through the German lines and reach the French city of Sedan. Sedan controlled all the railway lines that led into the central part of France. So the idea was if the Allies could retake Sedan, they could cut off the Germans from resupplying their forces in France, box them up, and defeat them. The Meuse Argonne offensive would be the last offensive of the war and would pretty much last up till the armistice. Rickenbacker ended the war with 26 kills. He had twenty-six victories. He shot down 21 aircraft and 5 balloons. He earned the rank of captain and was the commanding officer of the 94th Aero Squadron. He received 8 Distinguished Service Crosses, one of which was upgraded into the Congressional Medal of Honor, a Legion of Honor, the highest French military award, and a Croix de Guerre from the French government as well for his services. He also kept a diary that recounted many of his experiences during the war, and with the help of a ghostwriter, he published it as the book Fighting the Flying Circus, which he did fight aircraft from the Flying Circus, but Richthofen was had died before he got there, so he never claimed he fought Richthofen, but he didn't dispute how much they fought the Flying Circus. His squadron at the end of the war was sent to Germany for garrison duty for a brief time, and then Ed went back to America. Once he got back there, he tried to turn his experiences into a lecture tour where he would travel around the country as a paid lecturer, had a slideshow and everything. It actually didn't go very well. He wasn't the best speaker, and the tour was canceled before it got to its completion. These are the various decorations that he won, Medal of Honor, Single Service Cross, Coup de Grace, Croix de Guerre, and Legion of Honor. Coming back, actually, it took a while for Rick to be successful. He did marry his wife Adelaide, and they adopted 2 sons, David and William. He went into business with a car company. They produced the Rickenbacker 8 Supersport, which was innovative for having 4-wheel drive brakes, one of the first cars to do that. But the rest of the automakers kind of started a campaign that 4-wheel drive brakes were unsafe because all their aircraft had 2-wheel front-wheel drive brakes or 2-wheel drive brakes, and didn't want to change their things. And so they sold a few Rickenbackers, but it actually collapsed, causing Rickenbacker to take on a financial debt. He tried to start an airline out of Miami, flying passenger and mail with Reed Chambers. Their aircraft were actually destroyed in a hurricane while on the ground, and then 2 of them also suffered crashes, so that airline petered out. Interestingly enough, Anthony Fokker, who was the famous Dutch aircraft designer and designed many of the aircraft Rickenbacker fought with, the Fokker D7, primarily. He came to America with the desire to start an airline, and he partnered with Rickenbacker. So they tried to do Fokker Aircraft of America, but like his other ventures, it didn't really work out because Fokker was trying to build a wooden monoplane, and most of the planes had moved on to all metal construction, like the trimotor and other things. Rickenbacker did have one sort of financial success. He purchased the Indianapolis Motor Speedway and ran that pretty much until the 50s. He closed it during World War II. But his luck began to turn around when he purchased an engine company and was able to negotiate a deal with General Motors to sell it to them. The commission he made arranging a deal and selling the company allowed him to pay off his debts from the failure of the Supersport, and convinced GM that he knew something about aircraft, so he was appointed to be the head of Eastern Airlines. Rickenbacker revolutionized Eastern Airlines and turned it into one of the most profitable airline in the United States at its time. He did it the same way he revolutionized his squadron and the Prestolite racing team. He changed the route structures to make better use of the hubs and spokes that they operated. He increased maintenance reliability and on-time rates. And he, interestingly enough, fired all the stewardesses and only hired stewards because he thought that that presented a better image in a crisis than women. So that this is him with Eastern Airlines when he was president, and then Eastern Airlines was known as the Silver Fleet, and this is one of their air schedules from 1935 during the height of his term as president. Now, he had two experiences that really changed his life. Both of them involved aircraft, and both of them seem to have almost been karmic payback for all the aircraft maybe he shot down in World War I. The first was the crash of Eastern Airlines Flight 21 in 1941. Rickenbacker was flying to the plane. They were inaugurating a route into Hartsfield-Jackson Airport. Just outside Morrow, Georgia, the plane clipped some trees and crashed. Rickenbacker realized they were crashing and threw himself into a safe part of the plane, but he wound up breaking both his legs, suffering incredible internal injuries, punctured lungs, damaged ribs, but he survived the crash and went on to service in World War II. Now, he didn't enter the active military, but he was used as a go-between by the Allies, especially Harold Stinson, who was the Secretary of War. He was sent to England to observe how England was using lend-lease aircraft. And he was then charged with delivering a rebuke to General MacArthur over his actions, which they didn't want to transmit publicly to affect the morale of the military. So he was sent to Hawaii, where he would then fly on to Australia, where MacArthur was based, because they were repelling the Japanese attack on Port Moresby and things. So he was flying by B-17 from Hawaii when their aircraft went down in the Pacific Ocean, and they floated for around 21, 23 days before they were recovered. He wrote a book about his experiences at that called Seven Came Through. After that, and after he recovered, he traveled to Russia and observed how Russia was conducting World War II and was engaged in some early intelligence gathering for the Americans. After the war ended, he returned to Eastern Airlines, and by the 1950s, Eastern Airlines was dropping in profitability, so he was removed from his active position, but was made the honorary chairman of the board, and then eventually in the 60s, he was forced out. As you can see, as part of his lecture tours, he came to Texas at the 46th Convention of the American Legion in Dallas and spoke. And like several of his other contemporaries in Doolittle, he did a lot of campaigning for Barry Goldwater during his presidential candidacy. He published an autobiography, Rickenbacker, which goes into more detail on his life than obviously the book he published after World War I. And he continued to care for his wife, who developed a number of severe ailments. And in fact, in 1973, he had taken his wife Adelaide to Switzerland to a clinic where they were supposed to treat her condition. She had developed some blindness and some arthritis. And he caught pneumonia and died after lapsing into a coma on January 23rd. Of 1973. His wife actually survived until 1977, but became completely blind, and as the family says, missing Rickenbacker, she committed suicide. There are a number of sources if you want to find more information about Rickenbacker. The best scholarly source is the first book here, David Lewis's Eddie Rickenbacker, An American Hero in the 20th Century. Partially researched in the History of Aviation collection at the University of Texas at Dallas. So our sources were used in that. Of course, Rickenbacker's book, Fighting the Flying Circus, his autobiography, And then there is another more recent book called Enduring Courage, Ace Pilot Eddie Rickenbacker and the Dawn of the Age of Speed, which is more focused on his early racing career and his experiences as a pilot. Two archival collections that were of incredible help in producing this. The Eddie Rickenbacker papers and all his material is at Auburn University. They have a very nice digital collection. They have a lot of material from it digitized. And of course, the History of Aviation collection has an extensive World War I library and collection. And one of the ones we have is the St. Martin Photographic Collection, which contains a number of rare negatives of pilots on all sides of the conflict, French, British, Austrian, American, German, Italian. And we get a lot of requests from people who send in and write, my great-grandfather was in World War I, his name was so-and-so, he was in the squadron, do you have any pictures? And then we usually do.
Questions, comments, protests, comments, disagreements. Tell us a story that we don't know. Sometimes the audience comes up with a story that's brand new in the.
Well, I had a couple sort of things I debated about putting in, and there's one thing I think it speaks to Rickenbacker that I like. When he first started his racing career, he wasn't doing well, he wasn't winning. So he went to his mother and asked if there were any, you know, tales from the old country or Swiss, like, you know, kind of folk cures that could help you win. And she told him, yes, there was. What you need to do is get a live bat, and then the night before the race, you kill it and cut out its heart and tie it by a string to your index finger, and it'll bring you luck. Well, he did it, and he actually won a race. And then he went and bought then at another race, he bought the bat and left it in the care of a person, and they accidentally let the bat go, and he lost that race. So for a time it was that, but when he got into World War I and he started doing his reflection about being a pilot, he realized that maybe all the superstition and everything wasn't really worth it, because the risks he was taking, he needed to rely on what he could do and his skills. And I think that's one of the most amazing things about him, is his ability to realize when he was facing a problem and sort of fix it for himself and figure out how to do it. And I think he's very interesting, because we do a lot of aviation figures that we have with our collection. One of the ones we have is General Doolittle, and you read a lot of these people, and they pretty much lived and breathed aviation from when they first discover it. Rickenbacker didn't even get in a plane until 1913, 1914, when he was a race car driver. Didn't become a combat pilot till 1917. Only flew in the war for those very short months. Did some other stuff. There's some other things I could have gotten into. He always sort of felt Lindbergh stole his shot, that he was the one who should have been first to fly solo across the Atlantic, and that kind of led to a rivalry between the two of them. And he also got in a fight with FDR over mail contracts, and that led to somewhat of a downgrade, actually, in people's opinion of a hero of him, but he was able to work around that.
Questions, okay.
Based on what you said about his early life, it seems he didn't have much schooling, but he had a very strong aptitude for organizational and problem solving. Do you know what his IQ was?
I didn't read that in any of the, or have seen it in any of the material. I honestly don't know if he would have ever even taken an IQ test. His schooling was so forestalled by the having to leave because of his father's murder, but he was able to handle what was considered the tough correspondence course of the time in engineering. And he specifically sought out one that focused on internal combustion engineering as opposed to general mechanical or other types.
But I want to recognize this lady here. Her father flew Harry Truman and several times from Missouri to Washington, D.C. And he had paralysis in his fingers due to frostbite in the engine cab. No heaters. So, anyways, questions, comments, protest. This one, okay.
Did the American fighter planes have the ability to fire through the propeller?
The spot in Newport did eventually. They used a slightly different mechanism than the Germans. The Americans didn't really have an American-built fighter plane. The best aircraft we had at the time was the Jenny, the Curtiss JN-4, and it was largely used for fighter training. But by about 1917, almost all the advanced combat aircraft had figured out some form of interrupter gear that allowed firing and synchronization through the propeller. Interestingly enough, another a little tidbit. So the Newport 28, because it was such a high-performance machine, the oil that lubricated it was castor oil, and a World War I open cowl engine splatters a lot of oil everywhere on the pilot, and there are many reports of pilots who were exposed to castor oil and had to deal with that situation while flying. That was among the many reasons why they didn't like the plane.
Thank you.
I find it personally fascinating that 1903 with the Wright brothers, and 15 years later, 15 years, flying 5 miles above the earth and doing acrobats. I just find that fascinating. Questions, comments?
Okay.
So he was the number one ace for the United States?
The number one ace in World War I, yes, with 26 victories.
Across all the countries, too?
No. The top person, of course, was Richthofen with around 80 kills. The top French ace was a man named Georges Gamard, and I'm blanking on the name of the top British ace at the moment. I think... Yes, I think it was either Brown or Campbell. I'm sorry, I apologize.
Well, how did those kills by comparison?
Rickenbacker had around 80, 86, 88. Gamard had about 40, and I believe the British guy had 40 as well. But you have to remember, they had three and a half full years of combat. And at the beginning of the war, the German planes pretty much far outclassed anything the Allies could throw at them until France got the later Spads and the Newports. And of course, the British came in with the Sopwith Camel, which was probably their best aircraft.
So despite him coming in late to the war, he finished about fourth as far as aces go?
Yeah, yes. And that's... There seems to be kind of part of that, I think, is a function of being a World War I fighter pilot was incredibly dangerous. And for every person we talk about that got five victories or four victories or three victories, there are probably four who died 2 or 3 days after they reached the battle zone in a fire or in an accident or shot.
Got time for another one. Another one in the back, okay. No, you got to speak in the microphone.
Since you mentioned it was so dangerous to be a pilot in World War I, why did it take so long to start using parachutes for those pilots?
Well, they actually had parachutes in World War I. They were just discouraged from using them. But the Germans had a functioning parachute. The British and French did. But part of it was it wasn't considered the manly or gentlemanly thing to do, to admit that you needed that. There was a lot of that attitude among the pilots, if they were the elite, you know, knights of the air, carrying on the traditions of chivalry. A lot of it was they were still experimental, but the ones who used the parachutes quite a bit were the German observers who stood in those Draken, those observation balloons. They had parachutes, so if they saw a plane coming, they would just like jump because they didn't want to be caught in a hydrogen fireball that, you know, was falling down on them.
One last question. Okay, in the front.
I had the impression that you said that he and another pilot brought two German planes down intact?
Yes, they showed that in the movie. Rickenbacker and another pilot managed to force the one aircraft to go down, and it was the first type the Americans had captured. The accounts aren't quite clear how they did that. It was probably through a combination of forceful flying and basically getting behind him and putting him under the guns and giving him no choice to either land. Pilots could get close enough at that time that they could regularly communicate with hand signals. And there are some accounts of pilots whose guns have jammed drawing a pistol and, you know, forcing another pilot down or shooting at them. And early on, before they developed bomb racks, synchronized machine guns, all of that, when planes in the first years of the war were used just for observation, they would oftentimes just throw bricks over the side at people.
Okay, so the Germans actually landed the planes under force.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, they would basically force him into a situation where it was he had no way to return to his lines, and he wouldn't have been able, any maneuver he made, the planes probably would have been able to indicate that they cut him down, and that pilot chose to surrender. There were probably some pilots who would not accept that and would rather go out in a blaze of glory. It just depended on.
Last year, a speaker who was in World War II was forced down by the Swiss. He was a pilot for the Americans. Mm-hmm. He was forced down by the Swiss Air Force by simply the pilot from the Swiss plane basically went, you know, at the beginning of the war, Switzerland was kind of on the side of Germany. And then at the end of the war, they were kind of on the side of the Americans. Well, fortunately, he was forced down towards the end of the war. So at the beginning of the war, they were quite cruel to some of our pilots. At the beginning of the war, they invited him in for dinner. He was fortunately towards the end. But he was literally like this. The pilot went like that. They were that close. Questions, comments, protest.
Just as a final word, I brought some flyers for the history of aviation collection. I encourage you, if you get a chance, to come visit us. We're located on the campus of the University of Texas at Dallas. We're open 9 to 6, Monday through Friday. And we love to give tours and everything. We have some displays, we have some documents. I also left my card if you have any questions. But if you're going to come see us or get in request, do it before the end of October, because we'll be moving to a brand new facility that should give us a bigger and better space and a very attractive presentation of all our things. It'll be in a new part of campus.
Any other, one last question, anybody? Visit our artifacts in the bank. Thank you, Sally Lancaster, for bringing the artifacts.